an educator at the University of Islam, Brother Minister Louis Farrakhan.
To our distinguished platform guests, to our beloved brother and principal, Brother Delius Wilson, to the wonderful and beautiful brothers who are a part of this great graduating class of 1970 and 71, and to all of you, the parents, the well-wishers, and the friends of these graduates, it is indeed an extremely great honor and privilege for me and for the Nation of Islam and for my distinguished and beloved leader and teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, to have been asked and invited to deliver the commencement address to our graduates. The black man of America is in serious trouble. He's poor, ragged, hungry, naked, and out of doors. He has been taught to believe in a mystery God, and those who teach him of a mystery God are his murderers, his oppressors, his robbers, his exploiters. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad has taught us that God never intended for man to be poor. Therefore, he created an earth for us that is a very wide expanse, 196,940,000 square miles of earth, 57,255,000 square miles of land coming up out of water, 139,685,000 square miles of water, and this great planet weighing 6 sextillion tons moves at the speed of 1,037 1/3 miles per hour as it makes its revolution around the sun. And that great ball of fire that the astronomers call sun, with its great fire, sometimes belching out flames 10 to 30,000 miles from her surface, warming our planet, bringing up vegetation out of our planet. How could the all-wise God who created every creature to find something out of the earth and out of the sea to feed itself, to nourish itself, to perpetuate itself, to sustain itself? How could that all-wise God have created us to be poor, ragged, hungry, naked, and ignorant? How could a God that wise have done this? We must understand that this is not the desire of the Creator that we be poor. This is the desire of our oppressor that we be poor.
Minister Farrakhan became the speaker as a result of him speaking at our school twice. And the first time he came, he had a fantastic impact on the brothers there. And then he came a second time, we had the whole school down, and like, of all the speakers we've had at the school, we have never had anybody come there who could like have the whole auditorium silent for 2 hours, just for, you know, an occasional clap. So we have a democratic process of selecting speakers. And what we'll usually do is have send a ballot around with some speakers' names on and let the brothers vote on it. But this year we knew who our speaker was going to be, so that just to make it look democratic, we put a few names up, and then, you know, we voted, and that's how it came about. Mm-hmm. A unanimous decision.
Was his invitation extended solely for the students or for anybody else?
Well, his invitation was extended partially for the students, but mainly for the adults, because like we have a lot of disillusioned adults sometimes. A lot of our parents are disillusioned about things. They hear the word Muslim and they say, you know, they just get all upset. But we wanted Minister Farrakhan to come for an informative, just to let the people hear what he's saying. A lot of people, when they hear, I've said to people, Minister Farrakhan, he's from the Muslims, the first thing they say is, he's a Muslim, you know, blah, 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 they killed Malcolm. This is the first thing that comes out their mouth. This is why we wanted him there, because we knew we'd have a mass of people who'd come in and just hear what the man has to say. And as you can see, the result was fantastic.
We look upon the baby, we love the baby, we're tender toward the baby. It's a new life, it's a new beginning, it's a commencement. But yet we can't honor it in that state. We just are loving and tender to it. And it grows. And as it grows and matures, finally we see it begins to flower, to blossom, and to bloom into something of honor, something of greatness that we can bow to. But in its first state, it is dishonored. And so it is with a people who have been mired down in ignorance. Their state is as the state of a sperm, undeveloped. Undeveloped, therefore, in that state, there is no honor to that people who are steeped in ignorance. White people know what we're talking about, for in their first state, they were not honored. In the hills and cave sides of Europe, there was no honor for white people there. But when a prophet, a messenger, Moses, went to them, they heard the voice. And they came from the caves to seek their own. And now today, white people are honored and respected throughout the world, not because of the color of their skin, but because of the accomplishments that they have wrought through the knowledge that came to them. I'm not arguing their morality at this point. We'll leave that for some other time and another occasion. But we are saying that they have accomplished much here through wisdom. Now, brothers, graduating class, you are in your first stage of knowledge. And when I say your first stage of knowledge, we don't mean your academic knowledge. You're in the first stage of your knowledge of black self. For every one of you now are beginning to love your blackness. You're beginning to take pride in your blackness. Isn't that right? All right. To show pride in your blackness, you may wear a dashiki. You may wear an afro. You may take on some of the cultural past of black people. But in your first state of knowledge, the world cannot honor you. The world says, ah, they are awake. The world says, ah, they're coming to themselves. But in that state, the world cannot honor you and me. So what must be done? The Honorable Elijah Muhammad says that the black man must fill his head with knowledge, fill his head with wisdom and understanding. And as that sperm cannot be honored in its first state, we who will receive knowledge, wisdom, and understanding will grow and grow and grow into some kind of being that the world will say, there goes Brother Kareem, Brother Muhammad, not James Jones, Harry McGillicuddy. There goes Etiqua Lumumba. Look at what he's done. Look at what he's built. Not look at his diploma. Look at what he's accomplished against obstacles. This is your challenge, black brother. You must make a commitment this day to your people. These are your parents. Some of them 50 and 60 and 70 years old, on their way down into the valley of death. You are their new beginning. You are their commencement. You have the hopes of your parents on your shoulders. What will you do with them? Will you dash their hopes against the rocks by becoming junkies? Will you dash their hopes against the rocks by becoming so white-minded that you will strive for material things and forget the suffering of your people? Will you get wrapped up in some fine office building or some fine company of white people and say, I've got it made now? Is that where you're headed? Will you go to college from here to party, to play, to smoke reefers, to fornicate, to commit adultery, to live a low, cheap life that our slave masters have taught us to live? What are you going to do? We want to know and hear from you, not tomorrow, but today. What are you going to do? When white people open the door to let you into college, they're not letting you in because they love you. There's another trap for you if you're not wise to see your way around it. And that's why I love the valedictorian and the salutatorian. They were saying we've got to open our eyes to see the trick. What kind of foolishness is that that you want to engage in? You can't help your people that way. Don't go to college for simply to play sports. The world never honors, the world of wisdom never honors basketball players. The world of wisdom never honors football players. The world of wisdom never honors song and dance men. You've been clowns and buffoons and sport figures too long. I know I'm exciting a few of our guests. No, I don't mean to excite you. I don't mean to excite you, nor do I mean to make you angry, nor am I showing off. But this is their commencement. And for the first time, you have been bold enough to bring someone to a commencement that can make it a real commencement, not something that's just said to be said. This is my own flesh and my blood here. And when we see them going on, we don't want them to go on empty like we went on empty. Therefore, we intend to give them something to begin with. So you be patient with me just for 5 more minutes. If your seat gets hot, just fan it.
Minister Farrakhan, thank you very much for granting us this interview. Could you begin by explaining, perhaps, what the basic philosophy of the Nation of Islam is?
First, we would like to thank you for honoring us with an invitation to be a part of your great show, Black Journal. The basic philosophy and teaching of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is very, very simple, and it is basic because it is basic to the very need of the black man or any human being: freedom, justice, and equality. The teaching of Messenger Muhammad is designed to free the black man mentally. He's a mental slave to his oppressor, as we have been taught, reared, and mastered and educated by our enemies. And our enemies have not educated us in a way that we would be serviceable to ourselves and our own people. They have trained us to be better tools of service for a country and a system and a government in which we have not been able to get equal justice. So Muhammad's teaching and philosophy frees us mentally from the chains of mental slavery. It frees us spiritually from the worship and belief in a false religious message which was given to our fathers on the slave plantation to cause us to believe in some spook or mystery god that existed beyond the sun, moon, and stars. And we were taught to believe that we would die and get a very nice heaven in the sky while we worked to build a heaven for white people while they live. Muhammad's teaching makes us to see the reality of God, that God is, he was, and shall always be a man. And when man exercises knowledge, wisdom, and power, he's absolutely exercising the godly force within himself. So we're not looking for any mystery God to do something for us. We're uniting to do something constructive to help ourselves.
I notice frequently the two words so-called Negro and the devil are used.
Well, anything that is so-called means that it is called this, but this is not actually what it is. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that white people nicknamed us Negro. If we look at that word, Muhammad teaches us that it means something lifeless, something dead, something neutral. And after white people had taken away from us our names, our language, our culture, our religion, and absolutely divorced us from our past, and then taught us an alien philosophy, taught us in their strange way, then we became a neutral people. We were dead to the knowledge of ourselves. Therefore, we couldn't take a stand on the side of self. And being black with a white mind, the white mind made us want to gravitate toward white people, but the black skin caused them to reject us. So here we were in a no man's land, a neutral, a Negro, dead mentally, dead morally, dead spiritually, lifeless and hard. So we are so-called Negroes. Not really that this is some name to describe a national identity for black people.
Obviously, there are no white people in the Nation of Islam.
As it is written in scripture, when Jesus was talking to his disciples, he said, "Go ye not in the way of the Gentiles, nor even in the way of the Samaritans, but go ye to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Here was a prophet mission to a particular people to do a particular work. The lost sheep, we believe, is a symbolic way of representing the pitiful condition of 30 million black people. The white man today has had all of the prophets that he will ever have. You don't find lions looking out for tigers. It is the nature of every creature to look out for itself first. We cannot blame the white man for looking out for himself first. But where we find fault with the white man, and then we can't even find fault with him, in this way, this man has built up his power off of the sweat and the blood, the robbery and the rape of black, brown, red, and yellow. That's not racism. That is the downright wickedness that's in the very nature of the white man. That's why Muhammad uses the word devil. That the man is evil and wicked by nature. We don't fault the white man for this. This is the way he's made. And anywhere you find him, if you find him in Mecca, if you find him in Japan, if you find him in China, if you find him in Africa, you will always find him doing the same thing. He can't help himself.
I notice you quote from the Bible.
Yes, the Quran is the book of guidance of the Muslims. But we were reared in the Christian West. We were reared under a people, or we say Christians and Jews, live in the West, and therefore the scripture that these two people have, the Christians and the Jews, is the Torah, or the Old Testament, and the Injil, which is the New Testament, which comprise the book that we call today Bible. Now, as Muslims, we believe in all of the scriptures brought by the prophets of God. But since we were reared in the Christian West, under a Christian teacher, and we had only scripture we ever had in our hands was the Bible. Muhammad first elevates us and teaches us by giving us the true interpretation of the Bible, then lifts us up into the wisdom of the Holy Quran.
One of the points that I frequently see in Muhammad Speaks in what the Muslims believe is that integration is impossible, and it is now time for separation of black people from white people. How could you separate from white people in a country that is 90%?
Well, my dear brother, we are already separated. The white man is just now admitting you into some of his social equality, but he is not admitting you into the workings of his government or into the workings of his economic system, the inner circle of it. You are still kept out from that. We are separate where we live. So what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad wants us to recognize is that we cannot get along in peace with white people. And if we cannot get along in peace with them, why shouldn't we separate? But the separation should not be a form of segregation, which means that we are separate, but our separate status is controlled by our enemies.
Would this be separate states, a separate land that we would all move to and live on?
It could be. It could be. If the government desires that we be separate, since the forcing of us into their society has now produced very grave results. The black man today is a very angry man. He's angry with white America, and white America is angry with a free slave. The black man today wants something of his own. The white man today wants to keep us at her feet, begging her for the necessities of life. So this is putting the two people on a collision course. America cannot survive war without and revolution or insurrection within. So the wise solution is let the black man go, as it was with Pharaoh in Israel. Pharaoh had to recognize the fact that Israel had now grown to be a great nation in the midst of another nation that had to be free to do something for self. And this America is recognizing today. 30 million people is a lot of people, brother. That's a whole nation. You have on the African continent many independent African nations that don't number 30 million. You have islands in the Caribbean that are independent and they don't number 30 million. Here we are, 30 million people with more education among us than our brothers in Africa, Asia, Central and South America. Why shouldn't we pool our education and pool our resources to build up a great independent nation of self, since white America doesn't want us? She proves every day that she hates us, with an army full of black men and a navy full of black men and an air force full of black men that white America intends to send to war to fight to uphold a government and a country that absolutely deprives the brother at home of justice. Why should we be insulted like this to have our own black brothers fighting and dying for freedom that we cannot enjoy? Why not say like the people in the days of Moses, come on, let's buckle on your boots and shoes and let's go build a government of our own.
And whenever you want gold, you don't find gold on the surface of the earth. You got to go deep down under the surface to get gold. Whenever you want diamonds, you got to go deep down in the earth to get a diamond. Whenever you want a pearl, you got to go deep down in the ocean to get a pearl. And whenever you want the greatest of men, you got to go to that man who is deepest down in the mud of civilization. So the greatest of black people are those who suffer the most. The drug addict is like that because he understands that something is wrong with the white man's world and he's trying to escape it. But he's the most mighty black man in Harlem, the brother that you find on 115th Street and Lenox Avenue. Whitey, when he comes by here and he sees the young brothers, he says, well, this is his trouble. Because these brothers, you can't hook them on no foolishness called religion that got them looking in the sky. These brothers refuse to look in the sky for anything. So these are the brothers, the fearless young brother that's giving the white man trouble. So the only way he can stop the brother is to send drugs in the community to kill this youth before it can ever flower and blossom. But among these brothers right here is a great black general. Among them right now are scientists. Among these brothers right now are those that can fashion a world, but they don't know it, and the people will never see it until the mud is removed. And this is what Muhammad did for us. Most of us, a lot of us in the mosque, we were in the same condition yesterday. But Mr. Muhammad took us and cleaned us up. Why should we get our own food, brother? Because you know that the white man got all these stores. And since he don't love us, he sells us the worst meat for the highest prices.
Right.
He sells us the worst vegetables. He sells us poison meat. So if we're going to live a long time, and brother, this is the only life we got, we want to look to each other. See, you are the beautiful one. Not me. Not us. But it's you, the people. See, because we come around here and the television cameras are on us, we're not the big show. The people is the big show. See, we got to learn that this little life, it has but a short time to live. So if I can live this life to serve you and to serve you and to serve you, then that makes my life valuable. But there is no value to me if I don't serve you and help you. You understand? That's the way we're supposed to live. May Allah bless you, brothers. Together. Look at this young, strong black brotherhood. How you doing, sister? How you doing, brother? No, you're beautiful. You're the beautiful one. But what we want Whitey to see is that though he can think he's destroyed us, He put drugs all in the blood, and he makes us to think that we're nothing. Yet, in your heart, you know that you're somebody, and you are something. Muhammad wants you to know that you're the original black man. There was no man on the earth before the black man. You didn't have no brown man, you didn't have no yellow man, and you didn't have no white man before the black man. We are the greatest. All we got to do is get up today and be our beautiful black selves. See, and the thing that the white people hate is to see us showing love to each other. What he likes to see us doing is this. See, when he see a black man, excuse me, brother, when he see a black man hitting a black man, cutting a black man, shooting a black man, whitey drive by and say, well, them niggas are all right. They're doing just what I want them to do. But when he see us shaking each other's hand and walking like we in love with each other, then the enemy gets scared, because the unity of us is what will stop the condition that we live in. So, brothers, wherever we are, we should unite, and wherever we are, we should learn to love each other as we never did before. May Allah bless you, brothers. Thank you. Thank you.
Let's begin, brothers. Let's begin. I wonder, did you hear the voice? Come on to Muhammad and rest from ignorance. I wonder, did you understand that God blessed the child that has his own? And if each one of you would be people who love yourself as a people.
It has been 7 years since Malcolm X was assassinated on a bare stage in New York's Audubon Ballroom in front of 400 witnesses. Shortly afterwards, three men were brought to trial and found guilty of the murder. But circumstances surrounding the trial, the assassination itself, accounts in the press, and subsequent actions were so peculiar that 7 years hence, the question of who killed Malcolm is still with us, although three men have been convicted of his murder. We must ask the larger question, why was he murdered? What power structure felt so threatened by the words of this one man? There were at different times in his life three Malcolms living under separate names and philosophies, Malcolm Little, Malcolm X, and El Haj Malik El Shabazz. To fully understand the threat that Malcolm posed, one must understand his evolution. He was born Malcolm Little in Omaha, Nebraska, May 19, 1925, the seventh of nine children. His father, a staunch follower of Marcus Garvey, was found dead. Allegedly, he was killed because of his involvement in black nationalism. Malcolm was 6 years old. At age 15, after completing the eighth grade, Malcolm quit school and moved to Boston to live with an older sister. He eventually made his way to New York, where he was known as Big Red, and worked as a pimp, waiter, numbers man, and dope peddler. In 1946, when he was 20 years old, he was arrested and sentenced to 10 years imprisonment for armed robbery. While in prison, he was converted into the Muslim religion and became Malcolm X. When paroled in 1952, after serving 6 years, he was a devout follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. His first assignment was to set up a Muslim mosque in Detroit. In 1953, Malcolm went to Chicago to live and be trained by Mr. Muhammad himself. A year later, he was sent to Harlem to establish Mosque No. 7. An excellent debater and orator, Malcolm X became the verbal whip of Mr. Muhammad and the Muslims.
Well, sir, if we have sat around here for the past 100 years begging all of the white political hypocrites and every president that has taken office for some kind of freedom or some kind of justice and some kind of equality, and we today yet don't have it, then I think you can easily see that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is right when he says that the only way the black man can be free is when he has a land of his own and a government of his own and an economy of his own, an industry of his own, so he can do the things for himself that he now is waiting and begging the white man to do for him. And never gets done.
But no matter what happens, we don't teach you to turn the other cheek. We don't teach you to turn the other cheek in the South, and we don't teach you to turn the other cheek in the North. We teach you to obey the law. We teach you to carry yourselves in a respectable way. But at the same time, we teach you that anyone who puts his hand on you, do your best to see that he doesn't put it on anybody else. You don't have any boats or airplanes bringing drugs into this country. The white man brings it in. The white man brings it to Harlem. The white man makes you a drug addict. The white man then puts you in jail when he catches you using drugs. Who is it that controls the prostitution in Harlem? It's the white man. Who controls the large sale of whiskey and wine? It's the white man. You don't have any distillery. You don't own Shenley's. You don't own Old Overholt or Seagram. You don't put the seal on that bottle of whiskey. It's the white man. Who gives you the deck of cards and the dice that you use to gamble with? It's the white man. And after he sell them to you, he catch you with them and put you in jail for using them.
Malcolm warned against the drug threat long before it had become a popular issue. Because he preached separatism at a time when most blacks pursued integration, Malcolm was not fully appreciated by most blacks during his lifetime. He was often branded a, quote, radical militant because of his outspoken attitude toward whites.
When the Honorable Elijah Muhammad finishes opening your and my eyes and making it possible for us to see this white man like he really is, he don't have to worry about us integrating with him. We don't want to be around that old pale thing. We don't want to be around that old pale thing. We don't want to integrate with that old pale thing. We don't want to sleep next to that old pale thing. No, we can do without him. You find that old pale thing laying out in the sun, trying to get to look like you. That old pale thing. Find him using man tan, trying to look like you. That old pale thing. That old sickly looking thing. And today we see him like he is. There was a time when we used to drool in the mouth over white people. We thought they were pretty because we were blind. We were dumb. We couldn't see them as they are. But since the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has come and taught us the religion of Islam, which has cleaned us up and made us so we can see for ourselves, now we can see that old pale thing to look exactly as he looked. Nothing but an old pale thing.
On December 1st, 1963, at a public rally in New York City, when asked what he thought of President Kennedy's assassination, Malcolm called it a case of, quote, the chickens coming home to roost, which was construed generally as meaning he was happy Kennedy was dead. 2 days later, the press reported a 90-day suspension of Malcolm X by Elijah Muhammad for the comment.
Malcolm, is the realest bit between yourself and your former leader, Muhammad?
No, I wouldn't call it a split. Everything I know, I was taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Whatever I speak, I'm speaking that which he has taught me. Mm-hmm. And whatever position I've attained as a Muslim, I've attained it through his guidance and through his help. But during the 90 days that I've been silent, I have come to the conclusion that I can best help spread the solution that the diagnosis that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad gives of the so-called Negro problem in this country by continuing to remain out of the Nation of Islam and working on my own without restriction in the way that I think I best know how.
In mid-December 1963, the suspension of Malcolm X was extended indefinitely.
On March 12, 1964, after 10 years with the Nation of Islam, Malcolm X called a press conference announcing his break with the organization and the formation of a new group, the Muslim Mosque, which became the religious body and later the Organization of Afro-American Unity, the political body which leaned toward black nationalism.
That we will do everything within our power to bring about the complete control, political control, of Negroes over their own community, over the politics of their own community. And our economic philosophy, which is also black nationalism, is designed to show Negroes the importance of controlling their own economy. When Negroes are re-educated into the knowledge of how to set up businesses and establish factories, they can create their own employment, and then they won't be running downtown trying to boycott the white man or sit in at the white man's door or force him to give them a job. We want to try and show the Negro with the economic philosophy of black nationalism that he can house himself, clothe himself, feed himself, and do something for himself. And the social philosophy of black nationalism is to teach, again, it involves the re-education of Negroes. I hope I'm not talking too fast for you, but I can't help it. The social philosophy of black nationalism is to show the Negro how to take some pride in his own society, how instead of trying to force himself into the white society, how to elevate his own society and get some racial pride, racial dignity, so that he'll be socially acceptable to himself in his own society, and then perhaps he can get along better with other people in other societies. Make the city or state or government, which takes our tax dollars, channel some of these dollars right back into the Negro community and establish better schools in the Negro community with better teachers, with better curriculum. And one of the most important ingredients in that curriculum must be the culture, the lost culture of the Negro. Some effort must be made to restore the cultural roots of the Negro in the school system where Negroes attend.
You seem to have had a change of heart in your attitude toward Negro leaders in the civil rights movement. What position are you taking now?
Well, I think that the problem itself is so big that all of the so-called Negro leaders should try some way to forget our differences. I'm willing to forget anything that any Negro leader has ever said bad about me. And as I said earlier, I am praying that they will also be able to forget the many bad things that I've said about them, so we can sit down and try and find some common approach that can be used to solve this problem that's of common and mutual benefit to all of us.
After his break with the Muslims, Malcolm broadened his scope to include the international scene, and it was at this point that his life was threatened. In April 1964, Malcolm made a pilgrimage to Mecca. Here, at 39 years old, he received the name El Hajj Malik El Shabazz, the honorary Hajj being given to all who visit that Muslim holy city. From Mecca, he journeyed to Nigeria, Ghana, Morocco, and Algeria, finally returning to the United States, May 21, 1964. Malcolm wanted to galvanize public opinion against the United States for its oppression of black Americans and to get African support in bringing the American racial question before the United Nations. To do this, he needed the support of independent African states. And so in the summer of 1964, Malcolm returned to Africa for a four-month tour of 14 countries. In his autobiography, Malcolm notes that he was followed throughout Africa by persons from an unknown source. One of them was described as, quote, a thin-lipped olive-skinned man.
On July 23, 1964, Malcolm was in Cairo, Egypt, to deliver a scathing attack of Washington's domestic and foreign policies in an address before the African Summit Conference, when he collapsed in his hotel room with severe abdominal pains. According to Eric Norden, in an article, The Murder of Malcolm X, Malcolm was rushed to a Cairo hospital, suffering from toxic poisoning, and had to have his stomach pumped. Malcolm later said he had been deliberately poisoned. Throughout the fall of 1964, Malcolm worked primarily on his plan to indict America in the United Nations. According to Eric Norden's information, Malcolm had been under surveillance since he broke with the Muslims, but now there were as many as, quote, three different agents shadowing him at one time.
In early February 1965, Malcolm flew to London to address the Council of African Organizations. From there, he was scheduled to fly to Paris to deliver another speech. However, on February 9th, when his plane landed in France, he was told by agents of the French government not to deplane, and he was ordered to leave the country immediately. Later, Malcolm was to say, according to Eric Norden, after an interview with Malcolm's sister, that his being barred from France led him to believe that the plotters of his death were much bigger than the Muslims.
On Saturday, February 12th, Malcolm returned to the United States by route of London. 10 hours later, at 2:45 Sunday morning, the home in which Malcolm, his wife Betty Shabazz, and their four children lived was firebombed. The house was severely damaged, although Malcolm and his family amazingly escaped unharmed. In an article entitled, The Last Days of Malcolm X, Earl Grant said, quote, "Evidently, there were several degenerate persons involved in this cowardly attack. The one in the rear had lost control of his flaming bottle and dropped it. Had this bottle been thrown into the house, Malcolm and his family would have been trapped."
On February 20th, he called a business meeting of his new group, the Organization of Afro-American Unity. That night, Malcolm stayed alone in a 12th floor room at the New York Hilton Hotel on 53rd Street and 6th Avenue. His family had been put up by friends in Queens, New York. A man later identified as Thomas Hagen, one of Malcolm's assassins, would be identified by a Hilton Hotel house detective as one of three black men asking questions about the location of Malcolm's room the night before his death.
The next morning, Sunday, February 21st, the day of his murder, Malcolm left his 12th floor hotel room, got into his blue Oldsmobile, and finally parked his car a number of blocks from the Audubon Ballroom, where his organization's meeting was to take place. He entered the main ballroom about 2:30 p.m. Shortly after 3 p.m., approximately 400 people had crowded into the ballroom, sitting on folding wooden chairs. One of Malcolm's aides introduced him.
The New York Herald Tribune, February 22, 1965, reconstructed what happened from eyewitness accounts. The applause stopped, and the people sat down, and Malcolm's goateed face looked up and he said, "Assalamu alaikum," and the crowd murmured its response of "Peace be with you also." And then the two leadoff men made their move. They were in a middle row and they stood up and started pushing each other. And one of them was saying, "Get your hands out of my pocket. Stop messing with my pocket." Malcolm's bodyguards started to move towards them to break it up. And up on the stage, Malcolm stepped out from behind the lectern and he was saying, "Now brother, break it up. Let's cool it." He stood there, alone on the stage, with one hand up in the air, and he was a perfect target. And a man, police say he was Thomas Hagen, ran down the aisle with a shotgun, and the ones with him were already shooting, when the shotgun was right in front of Malcolm X, and both barrels raked him. Malcolm went straight back, and the sound of his head slamming onto the wooden floor was mixed with the screams, and he lay on his back on the stage of an old ballroom. Peter Bailey, an associate editor of Ebony Magazine, was a member of the OAAU and worked closely with Malcolm X. He was at the Audubon the day of the shooting. That same day, he wrote his immediate reactions to what took place.
I was in the rear of the ballroom, sitting and waiting at the entrance for the speakers who were expected. After hearing four shots, I ran into the main ballroom, looked up front, and saw nothing but confusion. The place sounded like a battlefield. I then dashed back out with a group of people running towards me and ducked into the bathroom at the side to avoid the shots. Immediately after hearing the last shot, I ran out of the bathroom and down the center of the totally wrecked hall to the stage. Jumping onto the stage, I saw Brother Malcolm's lying on the stage floor with bullet holes all over his chest. I leaned over him and saw that his skin was already getting that deathly look. There were several people administering to him when I got to the stage. I went into the room where others were holding his wife. I said that someone had gone for the doctor, not knowing whether this was true or not. I then jumped from the stage and started to the rear of the hall to see if the doctor was on the way. It was almost three quarters of the way down the hall that I saw the first two cops that I had seen, and those two were just casually walking through the hall as though they were on a Sunday stroll. This despite the fact that people were still screaming, crying, and the place looked like a battlefield.
Several questions arise from press accounts of what happened that day. In all three New York morning papers, descriptions were given of the capture of two suspects at the Audubon Ballroom immediately after the murder. In later editions of the same papers, and from then on, only one suspect was said to have been captured at the scene by police. And the press never questioned this.
An early edition of the New York Times, dated February 22, 1965, in an article headlined, "Malcolm X Shot to Death at Rally Here," said, quote, "The police indicated two suspects were being questioned," end quote. One of those suspects was identified as Thomas Hagen. In a later paragraph, the capture of the second suspect was described, quote, "Patrolman Thomas Hoy, 22, said he had been stationed outside the 166th Street entrance when, quote, I heard the shooting and the place exploded. He rushed in, saw Malcolm lying on the stage, and, quote, grabbed a suspect who he said some people were chasing. As I brought him to the front of the ballroom, the crowd began beating me and the suspect," Patrolman Hoy said. He said he put this man, not otherwise identified later for newsmen, into a police car to be taken to the Wadsworth Avenue station. A late city edition of the same paper only indicated one person, Thomas Hagen, was captured at the scene. There is no further mention of a second suspect from then on.
All early edition February 22nd newspapers were actually on the newsstands the night of February 21st, which is the date of the assassination. In the February 22nd early edition of the New York Daily News, the same thing happened. Quote, "Two men, one the reputed assassin, were taken by police from the hands of a howling mob of Malcolm's followers. Both men were spirited away by the police." Again, later editions made no further mention of a second man.
Because of the mystery surrounding the second suspect, several independent writers in lesser-known publications have wondered if he could have been a police agent. And several other questions follow. What was the other man arrested by Patrolman Hoy doing to make the crowd think him a suspect? The police never explained why they didn't release this suspect's name as they did with Thomas Hagen's. He was described by eyewitnesses at the Audubon Ballroom as a, quote, tight-lipped, olive-skinned man with slanted eyes. The same description was used by Malcolm for a man he said followed him throughout Africa and Europe. One of the most curious aspects of the events surrounding Malcolm's assassination has to do with Gene Roberts, an undercover policeman who infiltrated Malcolm's organization, shown here administering mouth-to-mouth resuscitation to Malcolm as he lay on the Audubon stage. The Muslims claim Roberts had defected from them with Malcolm the year before. He finally surfaced as an undercover police agent at the New York trial of the Panther 13. According to the New York Times, of December 8, 1970, Roberts was assigned to undercover work when he became a policeman in 1965, the year that Malcolm was killed, and did not reveal himself until his Panther 13 grand jury testimony on April 1, 1969. The Times says, quote, "Detective Gene Roberts said he had been assigned to infiltrate the organization of Malcolm X and was on duty as the black leader's bodyguard the afternoon he was killed on the stage." It is a frequent practice of white journalism for the press to convict blacks suspected or charged with crimes. Nowhere is the example of this practice more blatant than in the case of Malcolm's death.
Immediately after the assassination, both the police and press were quick to blame the Muslims for the assassination of Malcolm X. A quote from Time magazine, March 5, 1965. Malcolm's murder, almost certainly at the hands of the black Muslims from whom he had defected, came on a bright Sunday afternoon. The New York Times of February 22, 1965, in an article by Peter Kish said, quote, about 2 hours later, the police said the shooting had apparently been the result of a feud between followers of Malcolm and members of the extremist group he broke up with last year, the Black Muslims.
Besides Thomas Hagen, the one suspect police admitted holding, two others were later arrested, Norman Butler on February 26th and Thomas Johnson on March 3rd, 1965. Both Butler and Johnson were well-known Muslims who were out on bail on an assault charge at the time of Malcolm's murder. Neither was arrested at the scene. During the last days of the trial, the other suspect, Thomas Hagen, confessed to murdering Malcolm X, but said it was others, not Butler and Johnson, who aided him in the assassination. All three were subsequently found guilty and sentenced to life in prison. The court transcript of the trial reads, Thomas Hagen.
I know that they, Butler and Johnson, didn't have anything to do with the crime that was committed at the Audubon Ballroom February 21st, that I did take part in it, and that I know for a fact that they weren't there, and that I wanted to tell this to the jury, this to be known to the jury, the court, and the judge. I want to tell the truth.
Assistant District Attorney Dermody.
Will you tell us what the plan was, how the assassination was to take place?
Hagen.
Four people, two people sitting in the front row, man with the shotgun, short dark man with the beard sitting around the fourth row from the front, man in the back. One man starts commotion, says, get your hand out of my pocket. Guards from the stage goes after this man. Man with the shotgun shoots Malcolm. Two men on the front row shoot pistols.
D.A.
And which of these men were you?
Hagen.
One of the men sitting on the front row.
Later in the court transcript, D.A.
Do you know the names of these four people?
Hagen.
I do.
D.A.
Give us the names of these four people that you say you know were involved with you.
Hagen.
I will not.
D.A.
You testified a few moments ago that you were told to do this by somebody. Is that right?
Hagen.
I was offered some money for doing it from people that probably would have been revealed if Mr. Williams,
one of the defense attorneys,
could have continued his interrogation.
D.A.
I ask that that be stricken as not responsive.
The judge.
Strike it out. Although Hagen testified that three others than himself were involved, only two others than himself were convicted, neither of whom was involved in the murder, according to Hagen. According to the court transcript, no further efforts were made in the trial by the defense attorneys or the prosecution to discover the identity of the person or persons who hired Hagen and his confederates. Who actually ordered the killing of Malcolm? There has been much speculation. Although two of the men convicted of Malcolm's death were Muslims, and one, Thomas Hagen, rumored to be a Muslim, there has never been any formal evidence that his death was an official plot of the Nation of Islam, nor that these men convicted were acting under orders of black Muslim officials. The New York Times, dated February 23, 1965, reported that Elijah Muhammad denied that the black Muslim movement had anything to do with the slaying of Malcolm X. James Farmer, former director of CORE, felt Malcolm X was killed because of his crusade against drugs. Author Eric Norden notes that if the Muslims had their reasons for wanting Malcolm dead, so did others. Novelist Jay Kennedy also said it was because of drugs, but specifically named Red China as the force behind the assassin. Malcolm's sister, Ella Collins, said that his death was planned even before he was refused entry into France by the Western power structure. It has been 7 years since the assassination of El-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz, but there are still numerous questions left unanswered and many ends left dangling.